the Diamond Sutra. Meditation is relaxation. This is the last in the series of current talks on meditation and its various aspects. What is the significance of talks like these? You may read the matter somewhere. No, matters like these you can gain only from a living book. It is difficult to find a living book, and more difficult is even to read and understand that book, to be in the commune of these of that book. There are certain matters which are so intricate that these cannot be put into the words. When experience and the words are put together, it becomes manifestation of truth. I have spoken that from next week, certain series will begin. Series like, is a reincarnation real or myth? Then what happens? What happens to the soul when it leaves the body? Does it remain stationary or is there movement? Where would you find the answer to this question? It happened when the atom was for the first time being studied. It was found that it is stationary. But at the same time it was acting like a wave. How can that be possible? Something acting like a matter is stationary and simultaneously acting like a wave. Mind and the rationalization can only conceive of one thing. Either it is stationary or it is a wave. But when this question was asked to Albert Einstein, he said, logic is one thing and truth is another. Logic cannot explain the truth. What can I do? When I am studying and experimenting the behavior of atom, it simultaneously acts like matter. It is stationary and it acts like a wave, something that goes on waving. This is beyond the mind. Mind cannot conceive of a state which is both stationary and movement. So when you have asked or you ask a question like this, what happens when soul leaves the body? Is soul stationary or is it in movement? I recall, one day there was to be a congregation where Naqshbandi Sheikh was Maulana Fazl Ahmad Khan Raziyallahu Ta'ala Unho was invited to that. But instead he sent his young Hindu disciple Mahatma Ramchandra Raziyallahu Ta'ala Unho. The topic was Alam-e-Sagir. it was the conference of the fundamentalists, and Sheikh Maulana Fazl Ahmad Khan Raziyallahu Ta'ala Unho sent his young Hindu disciple, Hindu who happened to be later on Khalifa Khas and the inheritor of the spiritual wealth, and there he spoke. There are two things. Number one, there is soul. The moment I say soul, you start thinking in terms of something tangible. For that reason, it is light. Light cannot be manifested. But light can manifest itself through an instrument. The light that you see, that you know, when you turn on the switch, is not the light that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala spoke when He said that I took the noor from the forehead of Hazrat Paighambar sallallahu alaihi wasallam and put it into the human body. Oh, when it says light, there is a vast difference between the lighted object and light. So I will like to use the word consciousness. Consciousness, or the light, when it interacts with the instruments of the body, the process begins and understanding comes in. So what happens? And that light is never born, never dies. So there is no movement in it. It is the instrument through which for a certain period of time, this consciousness, this light, this roof, this soul manifests its quality. So when that instrument of body is no more, that light cannot operate. Something like the electric bulb. When the electric current passes through it, the filament inside connects the two poles, the positive and negative. Illumination happens. The moment that bulb blows, the electric current begins ineffective, it cannot manifest its quality of light. But what happens? Does the bulb forget the quality of lighting? Or whenever the opportunity comes for it to light again, will it light or not? It's something like this. You know driving, you have a car. You know, you understand the whole mechanism, how to switch on the car, how to give it a warm, and then you know the function of accelerator, the brakes, the steering and everything. Then one day you decided that you want to sell the car. You sold the car. So you have no more car. When you sold the car, do you forget the art of driving? Because car is not there. Have you forgotten the art of driving the car? Just because the instrument is not there, your understanding, your faculty of driving has become dormant. It is stationary. It cannot function. But the moment you buy another car, that memory comes back to you. You sit down on the car, you turn on the switch, nobody has to tell you that, or you do not have to go to take the driving license, driving permit once again, or you do not have to take the driving lessons, because for 5 years you did not have the car. Did during that period your driving skill faded away? No, it remained in abeyance. It remains in escrow. It remained in a state where it was neither stationary, but it was non-functional. Something like that happens. The moment that instrument of body and its equipment, the organs of perception and the organs of action, are no more. Consciousness, the light, the noor cannot manifest itself through, because the instrument is not there. Just as the moment car was not there with you, your driving skill could not be utilized. It's not that your driving skill has vanished. Your driving skill continues to be part of you in the same way. When the instrument of body is removed, that which is unborn and is never born, never dies, becomes the part. Another example, you have two building structures side by side, separate from one another. Oh, different rooms in the house, all separated from one another. You decide to break down the house and create a new structure. The space that was imprisoned between one room, or the room that occupied the space, was separate from the space occupied by another room. There was no free access to it because the room was occupied by someone else. The two rooms were occupied by different people. There was an entrance, and through that entrance, with the permission of the occupant of that room, you could enter there. But the moment the owner decided to break down the structure and create a new structure, the boundaries that were separating the room from one another is no more. The space is one. So another way of explaining the soul is then space. And the moment the prison that is created by the instrument of the body, or the instrument of the boundary of the walls that separated the space, one space from another, is removed, there is one space. And when you come in that particular space that was occupied by your room, you will have fondest memories. Probably in that space, when you occupied that room, you had your honeymoon. the memory of that will remain there. So it is a topic which cannot be understood through logic. Its movement is like stationary as well as a wave-like. And this is the experience which made Albert Einstein lean towards the deeper search, and he leaned towards mysticism. Topics like these, and is soul a reality or myth? They are interrelated. The series will begin from next week. Until then, today is the last session on meditation. This series I have used under the Diamond Sutra. Diamond Sutra was one of the most beautiful sutra of Gautam the Buddha. In this sutra, he explains to Subhuti the most intricate aspects. It is known as Vajra Chedika Prajna Paramat Sutra. Vajra Chedika. Vajra means thunderbolt. Chedika means that pierce, that wisdom, that sutra, that understanding which pierces the wisdom, your understanding, your knowledge. And it happened, Subhuti did not ask any question, Buddha did not speak, but Anand captured every moment, and he created that, and thus created the scripture, the Diamond Sutra. Diamond is the most precious of all the elements. It's not metal, it's an element. It is called Diamond Sutra. Vajra Chedika Prajna Paramat Sutra. On this particular sutra, I have spoken a number of talks, and all these are available on YouTube. Should there be interest in you, and if these talks touch you in any way, connect you to your being, you are free. My effort is to have these available to the people beyond time and space. Beyond time and space. Coming back to the last talk in this particular rotation. Now, it is here again important to understand that I am speaking on meditation. I have spoken on this earlier as well. How does this happen? The movement, my talks, the talks of an awakened one or the master, these are not horizontal. Instead, these are vertical. How it is vertical? Have you seen a spiral staircase? In a spiral staircase, if you make a mark, you take complete a spiral. You reach to the same spot where you were once standing on the ground level. But standing on the ground level, you cannot understand, you cannot see a clear, cannot have a clear view of all that is happening in your surrounding. If there is something going on the street level, and you are also at the street level, you cannot get a clear vision. So you take a stool or some, you raise your height and you watch it and you can get a clear view, a little better view. Then you go on a higher altitude. So a spiral staircase gives you that opportunity. You change your level of height, and from there when you look at the same event, you get a different view. This is how when all the cameramen or a particular event is reported live for you, it is, the recording is done that way. So the master's teaching is like a spiral staircase. Instead of taking you horizontal, he takes you on a spiral staircase, the vertical movement. Whether you call it a vertical movement or you call it dive into your being, it means the same thing. Because you are at the level of the ground, so it has to be said that height is the word to be used. So he takes you to the different levels of your consciousness. In one of the compositions of Meera, she says, this is very relevant, it speaks of the ways of the master. Unchi chal chal panth niharun. Unchi chal chal, I have climbed to different heights to know your path, to know you, yet still I have failed. You are beyond all explanation. Unchi chal chal panth niharun, this is exactly the same thing. And when we talk about the layers of the spiral, of the staircase, your being, the psycho centers, or chakra, or the mukam, from nafs to various aspects of nafs to various aspects of ruh, or various aspects of kalb, is like a spiral staircase. The master first allows you to journey through the various states of nafs, seven stages of nafs, then various mukams of kalb, then ruh, and finally he takes you to the highest realm, the open space. From where when you look, you get a clear view, and that empty space, when you are in the body and yet still you are not in the body. I am in the body and yet still I am not body, because what I am speaking does not belong to the known. It is not part of the mind, is not part of rationalization, it is beyond all that. Yet still I am in the body. Because it is the body instrument which is being used to explain the voice, the formation of the sentence, the choice of the words, is part of the noon, part of the body. And the being, the formless, can only manifest itself through the instrument of the body. For this you have to train your mind, through the technique of meditation, that it becomes relaxed. The moment mind becomes relaxed, something begins to happen. Mind has to experience that state when there is no thoughts. This is the state of meditation. When there is no thought, there is utmost relaxation, the absolute relaxation. No activities whatsoever, physical, psychological or emotional. And when you are in such a deep rest, nothing stirs in you. You know, when something is at the bottom of a cup, and a slight stir creates a spiral-like movement in the cup. Because this is how it happens. All that is unknown to you surfaces. So there is nothing stirring, all actions have ceased, as if you are fast asleep and awake at the same time. Do you know what happens during this state of dreams? This is a very beautiful example. That's why Hindus have called this life is dream life. You are sleeping, and in the sleep you are dreaming. You are dreaming that you are moving, you are going from one place to another. You are driving a vehicle. Are you really driving a vehicle, or are you really moving or walking? You are lying down on the bed and sleeping. But in the dream, you are walking, you are driving, you are flying. All these things happen. Are you really driving or flying? You are simply a witness to all that happens in the dream state. You are simply a witness to all that happens in the dream state. This is why Hindus have said, this life is dreamlike. If you can visualize everything happening in and around you as a witness, as you have done in a state of dream, then dream becomes a great way of teaching to you. Does it not happen in dream? You do so many things, you kill someone. You have lived an entire life with a person. You flew from place to place. You drove the car. All this you are visualizing. You are a witness to this. And you do not consider it false. As long as you are in a dream state, you consider this as a reality. But the moment you wake up, that state of knowing, that experience of knowing does not stay with you longer than an hour. Within an hour, the memory of that dream vanishes. All that you had done in the dream or you had witnessed, because you cannot do, the only illusion remains that you think that you are loving someone, you are making love, you are driving, you are visiting places, you are flying, you are eating delicious foods, but all that is happening in a dreamlike state and you are a witness to it. The memory of that only remains for 1 hour. And after that it vanishes. So that is why Hindus have pronounced this life is dreamlike. So when you reach the state of meditation, this is what happens. You are fast asleep and awake at the same time. This is illogical and mind cannot capture anything which is beyond logic. This is the same thing as Albert Einstein saying, what can I do? Should I go with the logic that my scientific mind understands? Or should I try to go by this, with the side of truth? The truth is, atom is behaving simultaneously as matter and wave. Simultaneously, your being acts as asleep, as an awake state. It became much easier to explain the state of what happens in Alam-e-Sagir when the soul leaves the body. And during the time when it has left the body and it is in a bodiless consciousness, it is bodiless. Is it stationary or is it in movement? It is both. It is neither stationary nor in a movement, or it is both. And when you are asleep and awake at the same time, you come to know who you really are. A poet narrated this state as, when the heart is asleep, the being gets tranquilized, and then you are all alone in the company of your innerness. The poet continues the lament of those who have drowned in the ocean of ecstasy. Those who have thus drowned continue to lament for those who stand on the shore. I am in that ocean, ocean of bliss. Sometimes I have to come out of that state and bring that experience with me to share it with you. Where it is my inner bliss, the silence, the oneness, the harmony, is assuming the form of words. That is why it can connect you. It is not a mere logical words. It is the words of a poet. That is why it is known as mystical. The path, the talks are mystical. It cannot be explained through logic. The poet continues, the lament of those who have drowned in the ocean of ecstasy, I am emerging out of this state of ecstasy to explain to you. And you want to remain standing on the shore and feel the depth, whatsoever is the treasure is in the depth of the ocean. Those who have thus drowned continue to lament for those who stand on the shore. Remember the ecstasy that drowns or intoxicates you amidst the storms of life is in fact the shore of the being. Remember the ecstasy that drowns or intoxicates you, the words that are overflowing. It is creating a milieu around you. It can connect. It has the capacity, and in certain moments when you are available, it connects you to your being. It gives you the taste of harmony and oneness. It drowns you into that state, or it intoxicates you even amidst the storms of life. You are surrounded by many problems all around. That's why you have decided to come to the meditation session. So amidst this, these turmoils, a moment or two that comes, that drowns you or intoxicates you, gives you the taste of the bliss, remains that alone. That alone is the shore of the being. That alone is the destination. That alone is the state, the absolute, the ultimate flowering of meditation. Through the vehicle of meditation, you have come. I am sharing the bliss in myriad waves through words and the silence between the words. Words you hear, the silence you do not. The moment your focus moves from the known to the unknown, or goes simultaneously between the known and unknown, between the form and formless, between the peak and the valley, you are being connected to your consciousness. And if you continue in this environment, the same music that overflows will start creating grooves in your consciousness. And then you can attain to that state, the ultimate flowering of meditation. When you are fast asleep and yet still awake, you come to know who you are. And then suddenly what happens? Another miracle happens. A window opens. A window opens, a window that gives you the glimpse of the unknown, a glimpse of the formless, that which is unborn and unmanifest, that which is never born, never dies, but no effort can open it. Instead, all efforts that you put together to open this window creates tension, and this tension is the cause of your entire life's misery. Therefore, always remember that meditation is a spontaneous, effortless, it is a knack. For meditation, one has to be totally playful and open, not remain in the narrow boundaries of the religion, not remain within the narrow boundaries of the religion. Instead, you have to be an open space. Only then you can enjoy it and you can have fun. You need not be serious at all about it. Sincerity is required though. What is my gain? that every morning I'll wake up at 4 o'clock after finishing my daily routine of exercise, 15 minutes before the beginning of the talk, the meditation session, the live streaming. I come to the studio to make sure all the systems are operative, the sound recording, the live streaming. What is my gain? Because what has happened to me, I would like it to happen to each one of you. The taste of oneness, the taste of harmony that I was given when the process began with one master gave me the taste, and then the entire existence, whosoever I met, sentient or insentient, the plants, the rivers, the mountains, the different masters, all of them gave the same taste of oneness, the same taste of innerness. It is for this reason that you, being engrossed into your ignorance, find it difficult to reach in time for these sessions. Sometimes I may have to wait, but even if there is a single person, I will speak. So you enter into it joyfully. Be aware that you are falling deeper and deeper into a state of rest. Meditation is not concentration. On the contrary, it is just a state of relaxation. What is the difference between concentration and relaxation? It is like holding a torchlight in your hand, and you are throwing the light of the torchlight in a particular corner. Its range of illumination is limited. It can only illumine a very limited space. It is necessary. On the contrary, when you turn on the switch and the whole room gets illumined, this is relaxation, this is meditation. Concentration is needed for certain reasons, but for bringing the transformation in life, concentration is not the way. You can use it as a vehicle sometimes. In order to reach to a particular destination, you need a vehicle. So you can use concentration as a vehicle, but it is not the destination. And when you are relaxed, for the first time you get the glimpse of your reality, you also come face to face with your being. On the contrary, when you are occupied, you miss yourself. In fact, all activities create a smoke around you. But this is just a beginning. But when you have learned the art of being relaxed, then you can be active and restful at the same time. There is nothing moving. Deep down, there is a state of no movement, a state of total relaxation. And out of this relaxation, it is the silence, it is the restfulness that is assuming the form of words and reaching you. A taste of no mind. A taste when there is no movement, when the form and formless interact together and reach you. You can talk as well as remain silent at the same time. Then the circumference and the center are not separate. Then the center and the circumference are not separate. Whatsoever is happening at the circumference cannot disturb the serenity at the center. On the surface of the ocean, there is a turmoil, but deep down in the womb of the ocean, there is utter silence. This is your center. You have discovered your center. Whatsoever is happening on the circumference cannot disturb the serenity at the center. It is like the ocean waves arise on the surface of the ocean, but deep down in the ocean, there is utter tranquility. Therefore, in the beginning, every day you have to drop all activities. And when you have learned this art, then there remains no question. You can be meditative even when you are in activity. Then you can perform all that is essential for life. And yet still you can be meditative. One Sufi master who worked as a head clerk in a police office used to be so engrossed in his work as if he would finish the entire work in a moment. And yet his every breath was committed to the remembrance of the divine. Those who continue to live on the surface or who have no experience of meditation cannot envision it all. Remember, for meditation the key word is relaxation. Arrange your life in such a way that all that is futile is dropped off. All that is futile is dropped off. And then you will realize that meditation, the conscious oneness, is one end of the pole of oneness, with the other pole remaining there. The two poles, if you look at your psychocenters, the lowest pole or the is Muladhara or the earth center, where your energies remain stored, and the other center where the energy has been released, it is the connection between the two. The earth center or the seat where the energy remains, and when it manifests through that center, it is nafs, it is sex, and when it manifests through the thousand petal center, it is light, it is awakening. Sex is the lowest level of oneness, and meditation is the peak of that oneness. The difference remains in the level of consciousness. The Western mind is leaning towards meditation because it has lost interest in sex. Remember, whenever any society becomes too oppressive, meditation will happen naturally. When sex becomes inhibited, all charms and romance is lost. Also, it will destroy the spirituality of it as well. And then the journey continues, a state of relaxation. In the moment, of passion, you become unconscious. And in a moment of meditation or relaxation, you become conscious. I have spoken enough to give you a glimpse into what is meditation. So it be. Another time, I will speak once again, but tomorrow I will take one more aspect with certain Zen examples, the examples from the life of the Zen masters. Awakening, the key to meditation. How awakening can be the key to meditation.